afternoon and welcome to the September 18th meeting of the East Bay Regional Park District Board of Directors. Our first item of business is the Pledge of Allegiance. Beverly Lane, will you lead us?
Please stand. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. And then we move to the approval of the agenda. Motion for approval. Motion by Member Rees-Gatman and a second by Member Rosario. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Hearing no opposition, passes unanimously. We'll move now to public comments. Madam Clerk, are there any public that would like to comment?
No, President. Aside, we do not have any public comments. Well, I didn't say that. I talked to him the other day.
It would be a great day if I were. I'd be very proud. Our consent calendar contains seven items. Have there been any folks who would like to pull an item? Or
yes, we actually have. Director Lane has asked for a small presentation on item F.
Okay, and then I would like, if I may, to pull and talk about item E. Nothing else?
No, President.
All right, then we'll move to item E, which is the approval of out-of-state travel for General Manager Robert Doyle to attend the 2018 National Recreation Park Association Conference in Indianapolis, Indiana, on September 25th through 27th. And I would like to read this into the record. General Manager Doyle has been honored by the American Academy of Parks and Recreation Administration, which will bestow upon him the Pugsley Award, named for the Honorable Cornelius Amory Pugsley. Pugsley Award medals are the most prestigious awards recognizing outstanding contributions to the promotion and development of public parks, recreation, and conservation in the United States of America. There have been many notable recipients. The first recipient was Stephen Tyne Mather. I hope you all remember the director and founder of the National Park Service. Lady Bird Johnson, for all her efforts in creating parks and open spaces. Our very own William Penn Mott. And East Bay Regional Park Board members Carol Severin and John Sutter. And he goes into the pantheon of general managers of the Park District, of Richard Trudeau and Pat O'Brien. So he'll be presented with this award at the NRPA conference. And General Manager Emeritus Pat O'Brien will be introducing him and giving him this award. So we're very, very proud of you.
Didn't know Cornelius, but what a name. This is a great honor to me over 40 years of my career at the East Bay Regional Park District. These are some of my greatest mentors and heroes in the park field. So what an honor to be included in that list. And what an honor to serve this district all these years and to be given the opportunity to have so many positions doing so many, what I'll say unprofessionally, really cool things to do, and having such a great board governing this body. So this is a big deal and a big honor for me personally, and I will graciously accept that. I do want to thank all the staff who supported me and nominated me, including General Manager O'Brien. And I think the district is extremely well represented on that list. So it's a pretty great honor for us. Most of the people who have received this are at a state and federal level. William Penn Mott received it three times, which is, I think, the only one I know of. So it's really pretty great. But to recognize the district and its efforts at a national level is very special. So thank you very much.
is so true. And if you have a chance, Wikipedia, the Pugsley Award, the recipients are amazing. They're just really amazing people in the parks and recreation field. So we're very proud of you. And we'll move on to item S. Which, for the audience, is the authorization to adjust and appropriate Measure WW funds and award a contract to CLE Soth Engineering for the Baywater Trail Access Improvements at Point Pomeroy Shoreline.
Great. Thank you, Director Rossby. Jeff Rasmussen, Assistant Finance Officer. I'm here today to ask the board to appropriate $500,000 in WW funds for the Point Pinal Bay Water Trail Development Project. And I'll comment with the, if this, this project is approved to move forward, we will have implemented or have plans for construction of the top 12 projects from the district's 2016 Bay Water Trail Implementation Plan. So you can see on the screen here all the projects that are either in construction or planned for construction by next year. We're shown in blue, and Point Pinal is our last crowning jewel, shown in red. So support for this project actually begins a long way back. It's actually part of the 1976 land use plan in EIR. Even back then, it contemplated having boating access out at Point Pinal. For me, this process really began in January of 2016 when I was working on the Bay Water Trail site at Point Isabel, and at that time the board requested that staff look into moving forward with this project, and also at the time the board directed staff to complete the implementation plan, which is shown there. We completed in October of 2016. In February 1st of 2018, we brought back to the executive committee an update on that plan, where we showed the accomplishments to date and the potential to open 12 Bay Water Trail sites around the district, and at that time the committee again requested that we take a look at Point Pinal. And then finally, the project is supported by the existing camping and campgrounds out there, as well as the shuttle program. It's kind of a long way out there, but it's a good option to have the shuttle that can take people under care out to the point. So as I mentioned a few times related to the implementation plan, we brought this to executive committee in February of 2018, and this is a list of all the top tier high priority projects around the district. And left on the list to do, number 13, is at Point Pinal. There were other projects there that are part of the implementation plan, but those are much further out and require a lot more planning and engineering before they're ever ready to go move forward. So I'm sure most of you have been out to Point Pinal, but here are two pictures. The one on the right is a picture of the campground, which is in a really cool former dynamite bunker. It's a great protected place to camp out on the misty shoreline, you know, but out of the point of Point Pinal. And then the picture on the left is a picture of the shuttle stop where the shuttle can bring people in their care out to Point Pinal. It's really a great location. So the initial plans for the project are to have shoreline access shown in the green arrow on the left and provide access to the camp, which is a big blue arrow shown on the left and again the green arrow of the shoreline access on the right. The plan for the project is to have an ADA accessible ramp, kind of shown in yellow, from the shoreline. It'll lead from the shoreline up to the existing disabled accessible vault restrooms out there. And also part of the project is to have, shown in red, is to have a storage area, maybe a wash rack where people can come off the bay, wash themselves and their gear off, and then put it away in a stored secure location overnight so they don't have to bring all their stuff to the camp when they camp overnight. But a lot of all these final details will be worked out with staff and during the public outreach for the final design parameters for the project. So as far as funding, I have to note that there is an error in the staff report for this project. The staff report comments that there will be $1.1 million left after this appropriation, and that's incorrect. If the board decides to appropriate money for this project, we'll actually have $2.8 million in WW funding left this project. So Bay Water Trail began with about $5.9 million of funds. Today, we've used about $2.5 million on projects to date. We're requesting $500,000, and as I said before, that will leave us a balance of $2.8 for other Bay Water Trail projects district-wide. And with that, I'll open up for questions.
Questions or comments? Member Lane.
Yeah, I'm very happy to see this moving forward, as I'm sure you know. But what I was wondering about was our earlier discussion about saying that this was a particularly expensive water trail site to provide the ADA, and that we might work on doing it in phases. And so, and I wanted to get to the ADA, but I also wanted to get it open. So you're saying that this project will accommodate all kayak or boat users. Is that right?
Yeah, that would be my opinion, as opposed to the Point Isabel project. Point Isabel is actually going on right now. That was a very challenging ADA access mm-hmm. project. And we had just a long way to go and a complex shoreline. This, I think, would be much easier to implement. It's much simpler installation. The grades are a lot flatter. So I don't foresee this being a particularly difficult project to do. And also, compared to Point Isabel, we actually had to go out into the water, deep into the water. We're here, we can stop the water. So now I don't foresee this being as complicated as Point Isabel.
Okay, and so the path for it coming up from the shoreline does have the correct elevations to be ADA.
I mean, that's what you're saying.
Okay, well then, I guess it was good we had that experience with Point Isabel, isn't it?
Start with Harvey first.
Yes. So I just want to congratulate you for working on it, because I think this is a perfect site for the water trail, having the camping already here, water and restrooms, and a very cool park too. So thank you.
Dennis, may I just, are we under Prop 68, is there any specific allocation of funding through the Coastal Conservancy?
I wish that either Tiffany or Lisa was here, or I was the grants manager, but there are a number of grant opportunities that we will be looking at for this project. We got the Point Isabel project, as far as we got water, we got funding not only from the Coastal Conservancy, the Bay Water Trail, but also from the Wildlife Conservation Board for Point Isabel, so we will explore all those options.
Thank you.
All right, thank you. Thank you very much, Jeff. Any other questions, comments on that item? Excuse me, Member Lane. Oh, okay, if you'll indulge me, I do have a couple more comments on the consent calendar. I was a little tied up. I was worrying about pronouncing Cornelius Amory Pugsley, and I was tossed up a little bit. But I would like to comment on item D of the consent calendar, which was the authorization to appropriate Measure W funds for dredge ponds and repair levees at the Hayward shoreline. And the history of that was, you know, we do go to, there's a number of challenges on repairing levees and getting permits and biological opinions, and we do go to Washington every year, and we lobby our legislators and our congresspeople and senators. I would just like to give or commend our congressperson, Eric Swalwell, who met with us, talked about this. We invited him to come to the shoreline and see what our issues were. He did come, and I'm not sure what, I know our staff worked incredibly hard to get this done and get everything in place to do this, but in fact, I would just like to thank Congressmember Swalwell for helping us out on this. And also the district's investment report for the quarter ending June 30th, I want to compliment staff and the Finance Committee for running such a fiscally great ship. It's great to read. We're in such good financial shape, and it's also good to be able to understand it. So thank you for the report from the Finance Committee. Would you like to move the consent calendar?
I'd like to move the consent calendar.
Okay. We have a motion by Member Lane and a second by Member Corbett. All in favor, say aye. Opposed? Hearing none, the consent calendar passes unanimously. We'll move now to the authorization to enter into an option purchase and sale agreement and transfer and appropriate funds for the acquisition of 160 plus or minus acres of real property from Gerald A. Grove, trustee of the Gerald A. Grove Revocable Trust, dated September 1st, 2011, from property at Newlin Canyon Regional Preserve.
Good afternoon. Suzanne Lusk of the Acquisition Stewardship and Development Division. I'm here to present a couple of board items, one for the Grove property as well as the Proviance property. This is for authorization to enter into the option to purchase the Grove property. property is located immediately adjacent to the Smith's property that was acquired by the Park District in 2010. It's on the Doolin Road right of way. Let's see if I can get this pointer thing to work. I'm not sure. Yes, Doolin Road's right here. It's just dirt that goes through this area here and comes up to the property side here. This area shows a little closer view of the property and shows the hills, windswept hills, and the Cottonwood Creek that has its headwaters along the Grove property. The Grove property is 160 acres. It can be acquired for $1,020,000. And it's anticipated that the close of escrow will take place no later than November 30th. This property expands the boundary of the existing park, preserves the headwaters of Cottonwood Creek. It offers potential recreational trail opportunities, and it maintains the open space and protects sensitive species habitat. The property comprises level to moderately sloping rolling hill terrain. I would call it steep. As I went up the hill, I would call it steep. With natural grass vegetation primarily used for cattle grazing. Open grassland with stands of trees. It's really nice to have the trees down here near the creek. And it provides nesting habitat for raptors. In fact, while we were there, there was a barn owl and two great horned owls. So it was kind of nice to see. I had never seen one of those. And this photo shows the valley on the property and the ridgeline. As it continues westward. When you go up to the top of the property, you can see that even on the property is, rolling hills, and then they continue on as you look out. This property will serve to enhance potential conservation and habitat, and it will grant a respite for birds that are affected by the Altamont Wind Corridor. This photo shows the willow stand adjacent to the Cottonwood Creek. At this time of year, the creek is kind of not there. The first time I went, the creek was definitely there, so it's nice to see. I took this picture then. The Cottonwood Creek drains into one of the man-made ponds from the creek. Cottonwood Creek supplies water to both the Smiths and the Grove properties and is a significant feature for the wildlife that frequent the area. This request is for Measure WW Doolin Canyon allocation area funds in the amount of $36,000, and the funds will be used to pay for the down payment on the property, the appraisal, the Phase 1 environmental site assessment, and staff time at this time. The Grove property will make an excellent addition to Doolin Canyon. The initial funding request will set the analysis of this property acquisition in motion. Please advise if you have any further questions.
Questions, comments? Member Lane? Pardon me.
You know, it just is so interesting to see another parcel come into our hands simply because Doolin seems to be a hidden treasure. And I just hope one of these days we're going to get it open. Every time I've been there, I've been amazed how quiet it is. And it's so close to two freeways.
Right there, I know.
You just really don't believe that you're in the location you are. And I like the fact that we're getting the headwaters of the Cottonwood Creek. I think that's terrific.
Well, and when I was there, there were turtles in the pond. It was really pretty nice. I had a good time.
Well, I look forward to seeing the property. So thanks for doing all of the work for us.
Good, thank you.
Well, I am happy that we have this as well, particularly because of the headwaters. And then a tiny bit of Doolin is in my ward. I mean,
we share.
The county line is somewhere in there.
Yes, you're right.
but I think that this is all in my ward. So, thank you for doing that. But most of all, I really love this map that we have. I think you have a close-up here. Do you have the one, the broader one that shows where it is? Because the map that we have in our packet is, oh, there it is a small map of a really large expanse. And you can see that this is not all that far away from Tassajara Road, on which we're having discussions about possible land that will come to us, possibly two large parcels, just sort of in the future. But you can see Mount Diablo and Morgan Territory, and to have a large open space park like that in this vicinity, and as we work on getting access from Collier Canyon Road, I think it's going to be a real treat for people. And I would definitely second what Ann said about the peace and quiet when you get in there. You know, I always look for that in parks, and the only thing that buzzes you is a helicopter or airplanes, because, well, or maybe a raptor.
They can in my case.
They don't really buzz me, but it's just a lovely space, and you can look at this and see that these two pieces are really pretty good-sized pieces, especially in the context of looking around. So yes. I sure appreciate your work on it, and I'm delighted to see we have a chance to purchase this.
It's great that years later people will say, when did the Park District get that? And we've gotten it years ago, so that's really nice. Forward thinking.
Any other questions, comments?
I would just like to recognize that board members can be very persuasive at acquisitions just by letting us know something's coming on the market. And President Waspy was able to do that with the contact he had in Castro Valley, who happened to represent the real estate agent, and we jumped on it right away before anybody was interested in it, so that was a great opportunity, so thank you.
You're welcome.
We do have one speaker, President Waspy.
All right. Welcome.
Mr. Greer. Gercher. Sorry.
It's easy to remember because you can't pronounce it and you can't spell it. I want to speak opposed to this, basically because of the map that I've shown you. I distributed this to the board. The problem is that you guys treat Southern Alameda County like it's Yosemite National Park. There's lots of open space in Southern Alameda County, but there aren't any parks. If you look at this map from the website of the Park District, all the P's, which mean parking lot, might as well stand for park because that's an access point. All the P's are in Oakland and Berkeley and along the shoreline. And the interior of Alameda County, the bulk of Southern Alameda County, doesn't have very many peas in it. So there's no point in buying all this land where the beautiful birds are flying around and you've got creeks and all that stuff, because the people who live there cannot enjoy it. All of these parks that you've got in the East Bay, which were founded 80 years ago, if you can believe the seal there, 1934, those things are completely inaccessible to the rest of Alameda County. You've only got about 40% of the population of the county living in the corridor going up from San Leandro to Berkeley. And yet that's where all of your access points are. That's where all your famous parks are. And yes, they are justifiably famous. But the other 60% of the county doesn't have those access points, even on weekends, because everyone knows the freeways, particularly the Dublin Grade, is like a parking lot. So what this board needs to do is to step up like somebody did in 1934 and actually create a park system in Southern Alameda County instead of just using money to buy land that is going to be habitat for wild animals. So I'd like to see some kind of a concerted effort to approach the political leaders of Southern Alameda County. For example, you mentioned Congressman Swalwell. Well, to me, the Hayward shoreline is just a bunch of mud flats. It's not a park. I don't know what you're going to do with it because there's no kids there on the weekend playing. Some in San Leandro where there is a true park, or San Lorenzo, but the rest of it is just mud flats. It's not attractive. It doesn't really add anything to the community. If you go to the other side of our bridges, there you've got beautiful communities. You do have Bayside trails, and it's pleasant to look at. Similarly, inland in southern Alameda County, again, you've got open space, but there are no real parks. So I want to see some leadership from this board, like occurred 80 years ago, to build a park system in southern Alameda County. And by the way, the reason Measure K failed is because the people in southern Alameda County know this game, okay? We get taxed, and then you spend all the money in Berkeley and Oakland. And what you have to do is demonstrate to the people that you're actually going to build parks instead of just put land into open space preserves. And then I think you would actually get some support from the southern Alameda County residents. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments.
President Wasp, just for the record, there may be a slight error in the map because I think our largest park in all of southern Alameda County is Del Valle, and it kind of puts the camping sign on, the ranger station sign on top of the parking. That's our heaviest used park in all of Alameda County. In fact, in the entire East Bay Park District, we operate at our cost 100%. The state park receives the highest use of any of our parks, and that is in southern Alameda County.
Thank you. If there are no further questions on this potential purchase, I will accept a motion to authorize this.
As the one who represents this part of the district, I'd like to say I think we have wonderful parks that both preserve open space and habitat and give opportunities for a lot of people who choose to come from Santa Clara. They come from San Joaquin because they love our parks. What I really want to have happen, we're getting closer, and that is going to have access for people to reach Duane Canyon, and this is another step in that direction. So I would like to move that we enter into an option purchase and sale agreement and transfer and appropriate funds for the acquisition of 160 plus or minus acres of real property from Gerald A. Grove. And I'd like to second that.
We have a motion by Member Wieskamp, a second by Member Lane. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, motion passes unanimously. Thank you very much for your presentation.
I guess the other thing I would just like to say, with our speaker is that these open space parks do open and they're used for all kinds of things. And this just happens to be, Doolin happens to be a fairly recent one where we are finally getting a good access for it. And then in addition, we are fortunate in the regional parks in that we have some special park districts throughout our area, and in the Livermore area, the Livermore Area Park and Recreation District has a number of quite handsome parks, and we have financial agreements with that park district. Thank you.
Moving right along, we will now move to the authorization to enter into an option purchase and sale agreement and transfer appropriate funds for the acquisition of 9.24 acres of real property from Penelope I. Heiser, sole trustee of the Annette Perviance Family Trust, Perviance, pardon me, Round Valley Regional Preserve.
Yes, Suzanne Lusk, ASD Division. I'm here to discuss the possible acquisition of the Proviance family property at Round Valley Regional Preserve. Let's see. During the 1990s, the Park District purchased over 1,000 acres of land from the Proviance family over a series of three transactions. Through these transactions, the final transaction we secured and right of first refusal to purchase this last remaining piece of Proviance family. acquisition will secure the northern boundary of Round Valley Regional Preserve and eliminate this private end holding. The Proviance property is immediately adjacent to Round Valley. I think most of the property that is Round Valley was Proviance property. And it is north of the district's Round Valley Regional Preserve and south of Marsh Creek State Park. Here's the state park, and here's the preserve. The Proviance property can be acquired for $1 million. No later than December 7th of 2018. This park establishes the northern boundary of the existing park. It protects the Marsh Creek corridor. It provides potential recreation and interpretive opportunities. It has the potential to provide a park security residence, and it removes a private in-holding between Round Valley and Marsh Creek State Park. The property has been farmed and grazed by the Proviance family since 1849. This acquisition is important because it provides the opportunity to close a gap between the two parks of Round Valley and Marsh Creek, and the property will serve to enhance potential conservation and habitat value of the Round Valley Regional Preserve. This photo shows an overview of the property along the Marsh Creek. There are two homes on the property. The one on the left here was built in 1950 by the family, and they used it for their family to live in. And this was built in 1977, later on by the parents. And the family has continued to live in them over the years. The quarter-mile segment of the Marsh Creek runs immediately adjacent to the property. In the foreground is the Proviance property, and this is our park, and the Hardy Canyon Trail comes up this way through the property, through the park. There are several older buildings on the property, of course, since they've farmed it since 1849. There are remnants of almond trees. It's really quite picturesque, and there's some of the older buildings. This one down below here on the left-hand side, because my pointer is not cooperating, is the old bunkhouse that the hands used to stay in. Miss Heiser's turned it into a she shed, which is kind of cool. So I don't know how historic these will be, but we will complete an analysis on the property prior to acquiring. Anyway, I can try and see if I can get to that page. Okay, so this funding requests funds from Measure WW from the Round Valley allocation area to pay a $10,000 option payment and other costs of the acquisition, including the appraisal of Phase 1 and property inspections. This will make an excellent addition to the park. They really appreciated the relationship that we've had with them in the past. In fact, the owner asked about Bob Doyle. So it's really been fun to acquire this property, and I hope you will consider it for acquisition.
Questions, comments?
I just want to say that I think this is an example of long-term conversations with a family, and as you can see from the map, ample infill between the property that belongs to state parks on this side of Marsh Creek and the Round Valley. And I think people who like to take the what's the name of the single track? The Heavy Canyon.
Heavy Canyon Trail. I've been looking down at the Providence piece for a while, and so now they won't be looking in the neighbors' backyards. So I thank you for working on this.
So just a matter of history. So this is Jim Murphy's brother's family, Providence. And so the two brothers inherited both properties. Mr. Murphy got the valley, and his brother got the front end of the property, about the same acreage, but this was very steep and had the most of the oak trees on it, but the valley itself was given to Jim because he was the favorite son and ranched most of it, most of his life. So he got the flatter, bigger piece. We agreed with the family that they could retain this property, but we wanted a right of first refusal if they ever wanted to sell it, since you can see strategically it's kind of a donut hole in that portion. There is no activity currently on the state property to the north, but that is a part of the Marsh Creek Historic Park for the state of California. That property has not been opened or improved at all by the state, so we're happy that we have such popularity at Round Valley. In fact, for the first time in a long time, where that parking lot is full all the time, it's become extremely popular for horseback riders from the valley. Met some wonderful Hispanic families that say, you know, we don't really have a place to go anymore. So being able to get into the hills from the farming area has really been a great benefit to them. So this is maybe it's a future site of, you know, picnic area or something like that for those people, because it's not everybody hikes all the way into the canyon, but it's a nice piece of property. I think operationally it could be important for future operations of that park as it continues to be more popular. Also, the opportunity to do some more restoration along Marsh Creek. Some of those buildings are pretty close to the creek, and so we can look at that in the historic preservation effort as well. So this is a great job to come back at this, and I thank Suzanne for her efforts on the negotiation.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Comment or question? Member Lane.
When I go out to East County, I almost always go down Marsh Creek to check out the parking lot. I sometimes hike, and what I've seen a lot of is people coming from Antioch, Brentwood, and just picnicking along the creek not that far from the parking lot. So I'm hoping that particularly people in Antioch will be aware that there's this beautiful park not that far from them and continue to take advantage of it. And I would hope that Rex and others, when they're maintaining the park, would see if maybe we need some more picnic tables because of that day use. There are a lot of people that don't come to do a great big long trek, but just maybe a smaller one and a picnic. And this is a very beautiful place to do that.
Okay. I had just a couple of questions. So, is there any plan for the two single-family residences? They look like they're in fairly good shape.
They are in good shape, and we've had them inspected, but there isn't any formal plan at this time because we have to do a historic evaluation and land use plan and that kind of thing. So.
Okay, and I know that it's a very strategically great parcel. Is there any plan for use? The orchard looked in good shape.
There's still almonds on the trees, but those trees are old. I don't know if they eat them or not. I didn't ask them that. But
okay.
They used to grow for sun diamond, I think.
So is there a plan for grazing? We generally have a plan for grazing if there's open space.
Well, it's a more of a residential lot, so grazing might not be a part of it.
Okay.
President Washington, one thing I'll ask operations to look at is, I think right now we're in a mobile home, the park residence. It would be nice to get that out of there and replace it with the permanent structure, and maybe where the park residence is now could become an expansion of some picnic opportunity, because it's ours already, and everything's painted green there, as I recall. Every Both, they like the green.
Both structures, though, are very sound, yeah. Very good condition. So.
All right, thank you. Member Wieskamp.
I'm going to say this might be one of Carol Severin's perfect spots for a short loop trail. You know, some people come there for a picnic. Well, maybe if they could just do a little trail walk rather than a monumental hike, this might intrigue them. So let's look into the idea.
Sure.
I think Carol would approve of a loop trail. I think Suzanne. Thanks for
sharing. It's all flat.
Flat is not bad. Right? For a lot of people, it's super good. So, thanks.
Thanks.
Is this your award? Okay. Is there no further comments? Any comments from the public? Hearing none, Member Lane, would you like to make a motion?
I move we authorize entering into this option purchase and sale agreement.
We have a motion by Member Lane, a second by Member Coffey. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, motion passes unanimously. Thank you very much. And we'll now move to board and staff reports, actions taken by other jurisdictions affecting the Park District. General Manager Doyle.
Thank you very much, President Wasby. The first item is been in the news a lot in the city of Antioch. Actually, the subject of two initiatives, one by the developer and one by Sabah Dabble and Friends of. I have to have Brian answer the Friends of, but we have provided a board a map now, and I think the overlay shows a lot on there, so I'll have Brian, our planning chief, guide you through that. And if you don't have a map,
Good afternoon, President Wasby and members of the board. Brian Old, Chief of Planning, GIS. This is the second initiative that that does affect what was known as the Future Urban Area 1 or the Sand Creek Focus Area within the city of Antioch. The first initiative was adopted by the council, I want to say a month or so ago, and we had provided an action report on that previously. That was a developer-sponsored initiative, the developer of the ranch, which had proposed a number of, I think, ultimately 1,100 homes or so within the area that you see is outlined in orange there. So the developer had proposed that initiative of a competing or companion initiative, depending on your perspective, was brought forward by St. Mount Diablo, and I believe Greenbelt Alliance and perhaps some others were engaged in that. And that is that's the subject of this action today, also adopted by the Antioch City Council on August 28th. And that affects some of the area within the ranch project site, but primarily relates to the remaining area of the Sand Creek Focus Area that's west of Deer Valley Road, so the area in light green there. So just for background, the City of Antioch urban limit line goes quite to the south and encompasses what was the Roddy Ranch Golf Course and was proposed for quite a number of homes all throughout that area. And then through a series of acquisitions by the Park District, those areas of Empire Mine Road were protected, and then the latest efforts and the initiatives have relate to the remaining area of that Sand Creek focus area. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Any questions or comments?
I guess just
So my question. For these, what are the implications for us in terms of helping to expand Black Diamond Mine and this section, particularly to the west?
Well, certainly there's some properties that have been of interest to the district in this area, and what this action does is essentially designate them and zone them as open space and hillside preservation. So. That is a different zoning designation than what was the previous zoning that permitted the area to be used for residential use. So that so we'll see how that plays out. But, like I say, provides an opportunity for future acquisitions in this area. And also, you know, one of the key features here is, and something that's been of the interest of the district, is the permanent closure of Empire Mine Road. Let me see if I can make this work. So Empire Mine Road goes through here. It's going to stall me out right at the entrance there, but yeah, you can see that black line that goes through there. So it basically forms what is currently the northern boundary of Deer Valley Regional Park Regional Reserve. And that's that road has been closed, I don't know the dates off the top of my head, but a number of times by the city of Antioch, most recently, I think, just last year for another term of 18 months under the state vehicular code. That is the last time that a temporary closure of that road can occur. So the city of Antioch is going to face a decision at some point about whether that road needs to be permanently abandoned or something else. So this action, certainly you can see the road going through that site. The road now, as a temporarily closed road, is used very similar to a regional trail. You can really imagine that area being a regional trail. I think a lot of folks in the neighborhoods to the north access that site through that area, and certainly would be a key feature when planning commences for Deer Valley Regional Preserve.
Member Coffey, so if I have this right, the developers' initiative succeeded in getting all this green area designated open space and hillside preservation, changing the zoning that would have allowed some development on Zika Ranch.
Yeah.
And then the second initiative, the Save Mount Diablo, et cetera, initiative, then subjects any future changes to that zoning to elections, which is, I think, a little
bit of a clarification. The developer initiative was just pertained to the area that's within the orange. So it didn't include Zika Ranch, and it didn't include other privately owned properties south of the property that was proposed as the development that's called the ranch. So the developer initiative just pertained to the ranch development site. So that's a sort of cross-hatched area within the orange box there. Sort of in response to, I guess, some of the early development proposals in the ranch, was this broader initiative that was formed by, led by St. Mount Diablo and a number of community groups engaged that does pertain to the broader area that does include Zika Ranch and the other privately owned lands. And then, yes, you're correct, it establishes a permanent voter-approved urban limit line, so any future changes to the urban limit line beyond what you see here would have to go to a vote of the people.
So it's a very good guess, and I'm planning as a planning mode to understand that because of that rezoning and election requirements in the future, that open space and hillside preservation designated areas are going to be preserved.
Absent
legal challenge.
Yeah, I think it's certainly safe to say that it provides a layer of protection to that area that didn't exist before.
And for the board's benefit, that area west of Empire Mine Road, open space and hillside preservation, contains two of the coal mining town sites of the five in the Black Diamond historical realm of coal mining sites. So West Hartley and Judsonville town sites are in those 600 acres there.
Director Coffey, which includes actually the coal mines under them. So kind of important that there actually were mine closures on those properties done by the federal government after a very bad disaster in Nortonville coal mines. The feds came in along with the park district to help on expert witness of where the sites were and closed those mines all the way out to Empire Mine Road. So there are coal mines underneath those, particularly the Big Square property. The other thing is that there is legislation that the district sponsored that said a city could abandon a road for their maintenance and operation and retain a trail easement over it, or give us that right and we could maintain the road. We have to decide, you know, the burden on us would be the maintenance of the road. But that is just a really ideal amenity to those communities that are growing out there to be able to have that road as a bike trail, and it's used now. The reason the road was closed was not the park district or St. Mount Tam. The road was closed because Jack Roddy, who operated the ranch that we acquired, was constantly losing cattle from vandalism, and that was a really wild west out there for police, and Antioch just didn't get out there. So having the gate closed and that road closed to non-permitted traffic by both private property owners and the park district has really reduced the crime out in that area. I mean, there was dumpings and garbage and lots of bad things happened out there. So we're going to work with Antioch to convince them that they have an alternative other than opening it back up again, because it doesn't go anywhere now. It does not connect back to a public road that's accessible. It goes up through a water tank access off of another development road, so it's not really applicable for public use at the north end in the subdivision. What it really does is define Antioch's future urban limit line, and so it allows for major expansions where you see all the city roads to the south and the crosshatch area, but says the remainder green area should remain open space, and both initiatives do that. Just the clock is ticking for any of the property owners to decide to litigate over either of these actions, but obviously the developer who proposed the original open space measure on Sand Creek only included his property because they don't have a right to go to others, but the citizens initiative was much broader, as you said. So this is these are pretty rugged areas. These are pretty habitat-rich areas for endangered species as well.
Member Wieskamp.
Are there any coal mines of concern that we would have to get closed in that area?
No, they're actually all closed by the federal government. What we know is, though, that they should be inspected annually, and they should be, as erosion occurs, as, you know, weather occurs, some of those can open. One of the closures they did on the Zika property off of Empire Mine Road failed, and they had to come back in there and correct that. I think it's at the lowest elevation of the water table, so all the rest of the mining water underground leaks out that lower tunnel, if you think about that.
Yeah.
And so you can actually see it when you drive out there is
orange.
Tainted coal mine water coming out of that. So they've had to monitor and treat that. So that's an issue in the future for anybody there. I think the federal government retained the requirement
of
the property owner. So, but everything else has been closed.
Questions, comments? Thank you, Brian. And the second?
The next one is a little complicated, but as part of Measure AA, the Bay Preservation Funding program that's permanent in around the Bay, a lot of applicants have been having difficulty getting all the permits needed to do the restoration. So the agencies, the regulatory agencies, and the oversight committee all got together and talked about how could they join an effort to hasten or expedite permitting. And, of course, it came down to dollars and labor. And so right now the authority has agreed to fund, and the Coastal Conservancy has agreed to fund some of that on a temporary basis, but they're still asking other agencies, including the park district, to contribute something to hiring regulatory staff to expedite permitting. The district is, staff is still reviewing that, and we'll come back to any recommendation on our annual contribution to assist in this matter. I think the issue for the park district is how big, how large will our restoration projects be compared to somebody that's doing a $4 million or $2 million project and we're doing a $500,000 project. Will that merit the type of complex permitting that we're being asked to contribute to? So Dr. Alvarez and Chief Grawl are all working with a team here to look at the pros and cons of providing funding to them. obviously, we have our own stewardship department. We have our own people who do permitting, but we also know that it takes a long time to get permits, even for environmental restoration enhancements. So we're still looking at that, but right now they've kind of covered the cost for the immediate future.
Any questions, comments? All right, well, we've come to the point where I've noticed that the finance department has come en masse, and if I'm not mistaken, hold on just a second, Michelle, there are 14 of your members here. If each of you talk for 10 minutes, that'll take us till 4:30. Would anyone like to take a break? Do we need a 10-minute break?
Let's take a little break. Should we power through? We're ready. I know you're ready, but give them a break.
Okay, we'll be back at 10. Sorry, Michelle. Thank you.
said he was looking for. Like, he said he was going to go to each trail.
Well, it was funny because we can't go
back. Yeah, when you called me yesterday, I said we'd lie.
I give up. I just kind of. That is true.
So this afternoon we have a presentation by our most excellent finance department, and Michelle Strawson O'Hare, we're going to make that presentation. I don't know if you're going to do any staff introductions, but of any newbies out there. So
I just may do that.
I want to know who's signing the checks if no one's here. Anyway, thank you.
Good afternoon, President Waspe and members of the board. I'm Michelle Strawson O'Hara, Assistant Finance Officer. Today, I am pleased to present an overview of district-wide services provided by the Finance Department and highlight innovations and accomplishments achieved over the past few years. I'll start with a brief overview of the department. Finance is a part of Finance and Management Services, which includes grants, information services, and office services, and central stores. We have three main areas in finance: budgeting, which includes functions such as investment management and debt administration, internal audit, which includes field audits and contract review, and accounting, which includes payroll, accounts payable, and financial reporting units. We have 21 staff members in finance, many of whom are here today. I'd like to take a moment to introduce first our accounts payable unit. If you could please stand. Thank you. And then next, our payroll group. If they could please stand, be recognized. Thank you. So those are our two largest units in finance. And then we also have our general ledger, accounts receivable, budget, internal audit groups, and administrative staff, if they would like to stand. Thank you. And we have some new team members in finance. Mary, Aridum, and Grace all started in this year in 2018, so they're a great addition to our department. In terms of achievements, the district continues to be recognized for financial reporting and budgeting by the Government Finance Officers Association, receiving awards for the past 17 and 14 consecutive years, respectively. And this year, the Park District also received its certification from the California Municipal Treasurers Association for its investment policy. In terms of innovations, we established an irrevocable pension trust to set aside funding for anticipated increased pension costs, and we provided funding of approximately $5 million to date. The district also issued new Measure WW bonds, including certified green bonds, and refunded 2009 WW bonds to save taxpayers approximately $7.7 million. From a technology standpoint, district provides online time card reporting, paperless accounts payable, workflow routing for online approvals, and electronic payments for retirees and other vendors.
We completed a financial software upgrade during the year and continue to support employees' payroll needs through the district employee online. We greatly appreciate our information services department for supporting us in these endeavors. Finance touches many transactions and processes. We work very closely with our human resources department in payroll processing, employee MOU implementation, retiree payments, and ICMA deferred compensation programs. Finance provides training and support to ASD on contracts and project budgets. We work with operations on vehicle replacement schedules and assisted with the selection of the new construction maintenance and management software. Finance also collaborated with the foundation to roll out and administer membership sales at select parks, as well as manage grant tracking. Beginning in 2017, the Park District identified district-wide performance measures as part of our budgeting process, and Finance is supporting the general manager in coordinating and reporting on the progress of the 2018 goals. Customer service is key to our department. Our helpful and friendly staff supports our internal and external customers in a variety of ways. We provide accurate and timely employee payroll and vendor payments, and employee pay stubs and W-2s are available on our employee online portal. Payroll pay cards, as an alternative to direct deposits, are offered to employees, and we provide internal audit services and a variety of district-wide finance trainings that I'll cover in more detail shortly. And every year, our department sends out a customer service survey to all employees to help identify areas for improvement and requests for future training. Results from our last payroll survey indicated excellent or good overall, with courtesy and professionalism ranking the highest at 94% and clarity of process with lowest at 84%. In response to this, we prepared several new reference materials for employees, such as how to read a pay stub and how to prepare your time card when you're a secondary acting physician. Similarly, accounts payable had excellent or good results on average, with the highest ranking in clarity of process and the lowest in promptness, which can be attributed to accounts payable staff turnover during the year. You'll notice there was a dip back in 2012 when the district moved to paperless accounts payable vendor invoice processing, and then again in 2015 when we completed our One Solution financial software upgrade from IFAS. And obviously, we've since recovered from that. Other survey results indicated that the Park District staff wanted more One Solution financial software training related to purchasing and invoice payments. In response, the accounts payable group created a comprehensive hands-on training program, which is available to all Park District staff. Some additional trainings include an overview of finance, fundamentals for supervisor, budget planning workshops, and project budgeting, cash receipts handling, and online training for credit card holders. Next, I wanted to highlight some trends we're seeing on the payroll side. Over the past 5 years, the Park District has seen a 6% increase in staffing levels during the peak season, reaching 1,031 in 2018. Payroll is a very deadline-driven function, and our staff is especially diligent in verifying the accuracy of all payroll components and compliance with MOUs. As parks and programs expand, accounts payable transactions have also increased. Credit card transactions have gone up by almost 19%, and the number of invoices processed increased approximately 14% over the past 5 years. With accounts payable, each transaction, regardless of the dollar amount, requires thorough review and verification of sales and use tax calculations, invoice amounts, and approvals. It's a big responsibility, and our staff does an excellent job providing accurate vendor payments through strong internal controls. In closing, the finance department consistently presents strong financial and budget reporting and is on the cutting edge of technological innovations. Our most recent survey provided very positive results and important feedback on needed trainings. We are looking forward forward to another great year. Does anyone have any questions or comments?
Questions, comments? Member Lane.
So, two things. Do the staff and finance get a chance to get out in the parks?
We certainly do. Yeah, we're fortunate enough to have our division meetings usually every quarter at a park. Most recently, in I believe it was May, we went to Sanol, which was fantastic. And we have another one planned, a big break, in October next month.
Okay, because I think that's really important for everybody in the park district, particularly when you're in Peralta Oaks and you need to get out.
Yeah, I agree.
And my second question is, if you're going to look to this next year, what would you say are a couple of your major challenges?
Well, I believe we're going to embark on another financial software upgrade next year, and that one will be more significant changes than the ones we encountered this year. So I'm imagining we'll have to do some good training, district-wide training for employees using that software. That's definitely one. Deborah, did you have anything you wanted to add? Oh, the two-year budget. I believe that's a project that we're considering for our next budget season, to move toward from an annual to a two-year budget.
Member Corbett.
I just wanted to say thank you as the treasurer for the board, my first year as treasurer, when I saw that that was going to be my assignment after being a new member. It seemed quite daunting. But I just want to thank you for the amazing support and professionalism from this department, which of course supports the work of the Finance Committee. So thank you. You make it easy. We'll answer all our questions and make sure we're doing what we should be to take care of taxpayers' money. So thank you very much.
Thank you. We appreciate that.
I'm always impressed whether you're out there auditing, whether you're training, whether you're trying to help us get through some of these long changes. You really try to help the board understand what's happening in the district, and you handle an awful lot of money, and I think you do it very well. So thank you so much for making us look.
Two or three people remember Irmgard. Irmgard used to almost run the whole finance department. She was in charge of the payroll, and she would call me every 2 weeks explaining why I was a knucklehead and why they couldn't do my title card correctly. But she would do it with a lot of other people, too. But I agree. You guys are very impressive. You're very innovative and very understandable, too. So thank you so much. Of course, you're invited to stay for the rest of the day, if you so choose. Moving along with the GM comments, we have a whole list of accomplishments.
Yes, we have all of the list of activities throughout the district, and I think I have the right people here if you have any questions for that.
Any questions, comments? Hearing none, we'll move right to announcements from the closed session.
President Wansby, the board authorized unanimously in two separate matters and unrelated matters the filing of litigation, the particulars of which will be made public when an action is on file.
Move to public comments. The last chance for public comments. Hearing no public comments. Thank you, members of the public, for sticking it out, staying here, and being here.
President Wasby, just I would like to call attention to the press clippings, the abundance of fire stories, and our efforts. Again, our helicopter has dropped over 100 drops this year, which exceeds any year in our history. and none of them have become big fires because we get there first and then the cavalry from Cal Fire comes in. So just a very large amount of fire issues across the state, but even recognition of what we're trying to do in the East Bay to reduce those fires. We're not going to stop them, but we can reduce the size if we get there with our great staff.
Thank you. Okay, we'll move to board comments. Member Coffey.
So I wanted to again apologize for missing the board field trip on September 7th. I was in Carmel for a meeting, which was rough, I know, but it was interesting. Emil and I got to visit Garland Regional Park in Carmel Valley, which is the flagship park of the Monterey Regional Park District. So we took some notes, and I will share them with staff at some point. On September 8th, I attended with many of you the Moonlight on the Mountain Save Mount Diablo fundraiser, which once again was a superb event and lots of fun. On the 9th, Mila and I manned the staffed, I should say, the Park District table at the Solano Stroll Annual event that attracts tens of thousands of people up and down Solano Avenue. Thought that our engagement with people as they were passing by was very interesting and effective for our distribution of information about the Park District. On the 10th, I attended with Supervisor Federal Glover the dedication of the Los Juntas Elementary School renovated ball field, which was funded with about $500,000 of Measure WW local funding. So we had, this is out in Pacheco, had a nice crowd of kids and parents and school district folks who were thankful for the WW funding and the county's leadership in helping plan the project. On the 12th, I was able to attend two very happy events. One was in the morning, the City of Hercules dedicated its portion of the Bay Trail, newly paved between the Bayfront area and south of there to existing residential area where we have access on the Bay Trail going down to Pinole. And then, of course, the Pinole Shores Bridge dedication took place, and we had a fabulous crowd and a lot of very happy people who were checking out the newly opened bridge. Lastly, yesterday, Mila and I helped staff the Black Diamond Mine open house, as we do about four or five times a year, and always enjoy that. And interestingly enough, I find from these ambassador events that we do that our park users are actually very mobile. They get around from the far-flung regions of these two counties. I think I encountered maybe half a dozen people who said they were there coming from, say, Fremont or Hayward or Pleasanton. Why? Because they heard about the mine and the new awesome new stairs and tour. And so people actually do travel fairly significant distances to get to many of our parks.
Thank you. Member Corbett.
I did attend the Coyote Hills field trip and New Dunbarton by the Bay campground trip. I'm sure Anne will have a lot to say about that as it's in her district, but what an exciting opportunity for the future of this park district to have that amazing campground so close in to such a populated area. It's just going to be on the 8th, I attended the Garin Apple Harvest Festival, which is always fun. I've probably tasted about 14 different types of apples. There was ice cream and beignets and lots of excited young people dancing to the old-time band. And the blacksmith shop was open and running
also with Dave Collins and his two sons. So that was really awesome, and got an opportunity to connect with some master gardeners who help in the apple orchard. I also attended Moonlight on the Mountain on the 8th, which was a fabulous event. So nice to have such great partners at Open Space. On the 13th, I attended the Operations Committee meeting. And then also in the evening of the 13th, I had an opportunity to attend with some of my colleagues, the Park Foundation's Radke Award, honoring an amazing young legislator who needs to take a bow. I stopped Assemblymember Eduardo Garcia and I said, you know, as legislators, people get very, very busy and they don't stop to think about what they just did. And I said, you should really understand how phenomenal it was to lead that charge to get a bond measure for parks on the ballot. And he said, oh, he goes, I'm always on to the next thing, you're right. But in any event, I think it was very nice that we honored legislators from Southern California, but it has such an impact on parks, what we care about statewide. So that was a great event. That's it.
Thank you. Member Rosario.
Yeah, on September 7th, I also attended with Fitcher County Hills, and I was very, very impressed with that we got to go along with the class there with our naturalist, and they are so good. I think we are really lucky to have such great, enthusiastic staff members that teaching the young kids today. I learned a lot, and just watching them work is just amazing. Very impressed, and the Future Campground, it's going to be huge benefit to Alameda County, especially Southern Alameda County. On September 8th, attended the David Robert Dunder Sierra Club. Nice event. Eric Schneiderman was received an award there, and he made sure to make sure that to remind me that the Altamont Alameda County money is still there. And then on the 12th, I attended the Pinole Bay Trail ribbon cutting ceremony. Wow, what a nice, incredible structure, nice event. The view of the marsh there is just gorgeous. And it's just funny. It's like when I take the train, anytime I go to Sacramento, I always take the train. And you never look, you never notice, you don't pay attention to looking to the east. Your eyes are always focused on the water. And it's just a gorgeous, gorgeous event. And congratulations to the Park District. I mean, the vision there was just incredible. And I feel lucky to be part of it. And then on the 14th, I attended the Alameda County Farm Bureau barbecue. And what a nice little event. No speeches, just a nice dinner. You meet, rubbed elbows with a lot of the employees from the Alameda County, and also the mayor, council members from Fremont, Union City were there. Also got, it was kind of a reunion with Elizabeth McGilligut from Alameda County Parks Recreation Historic Commission, which Dennis and I both served on. And she passed a little tidbit about, because I remember as a kid that there used to be a lot of nurseries there for cut flowers. And the history there was that the federal government, in order to try to sway Ecuador from growing cocoa, harvesting cocoa, we kind of encouraged them to grow cut flowers. And so all those nurseries that were in Fremont closed down and went to Ecuador. And so the families that ran those nurseries basically got pushed out of business. So it's very interesting. Nice tidbit of history. And then on September 17th, I met with some folks from the Redwood Arena. They were concerned about a gate that needed to go up there at the top. And had a good meeting and conveyed my notes to Dan Sykes, their meeting today. But that's some good ideas. It's nice to see that area there is really recovered from the initial closure from the Serpentine Prairie. It's really, everything's gone back. It's nice. But there's some potential there for my concern there around the Redwood Marina was that access for fire vehicles, because we, right now there's no access for fire vehicles once you get past the main road. So I've sent those concerns down to Dan. And then that's it. Been very, very busy with on behalf of the campaign for Measure MF, so lots and lots of meetings and events. So that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Dean. Member Dodson.
Richmond Shoreline Festival is coming up October the 6th, and that's going to entail some more work, but certainly it's coming along good. I'll be attending the next meeting. I had a conflict with the last meeting, and what else? I think that's it.
Thank you. Member Wieskamp.
I attended the executive committee meeting, and the field trip I thought was terrific to Coyote Hills. What an impressive third grade class. And what I liked throughout the whole thing was our staff never talks down to them. You know, it's just, it's a good conversation. Everybody was engaged. The parents and teachers who were along seemed to enjoy it. And certainly some of our big kids enjoyed it, too, and got involved with it. So it was a great experience. I thought it was a good idea. And obviously, I'm excited about Dumbarton Quarry opening and the trail connections. And let's not forget that we're also in the middle of planning for the Patterson land. So there's lots going on at Coyote Hills. And it's a beautiful park that people are really appreciating. And I like the fact that we're getting the new companies that have moved in involved. They're actually doing outreach, inviting them to come over, and a lot of them are walking at noon, but we hope we'll improve their safety on the roadway there. Attended operations, and yesterday I had the opportunity to go to the staging area of Pleasanton Ridge for Foundation, where they're going to do a special feature on Emily Schultz, who, remember, we just approved the name of the trail in honor of her husband. But let me tell you, the star of the photos is going to be Poppy. Poppy is a 15-year-old Cocker Spaniel who was amazingly lively, gray ears and all. And so we all agree that she was going to be the star of the photos. But Emily is such a great person, so positive. They're engaged in more fundraising, and they know they're going to come up with enough to cover the cost of building that trail. And so I really appreciated the opportunity to see her again. And on Thursday, I have a LAFCO meeting, and that's always interesting. That's it. Thanks.
Thank you. Member Lane.
Thank you. I want to start by passing out a little real estate picture of some homes along Remington Loop in Danville. One of the things we talked about was access off the street at the Padva development, if you remember that. This is a home that's along Remington Loop, which also has a local access into Las Trompas. And I will say that having that local access doesn't seem to diminish the value of the houses. Okay, so I went to the executive committee. I went to also to the board field trip. Enjoyed that very much. I mean, looking down at Dumbarton Campground by bay from the hill was just an astonishing experience. I never thought that huge hole would be filled up as rapidly, and evidently they didn't think so either. At Coyote, I was very impressed by the there was a fountain and a new entry on the right, new entry in the outside the door going into Coyote Hills. It looked much better than it has in the past. And also, you could see that I think they were expecting the board at Coyote inside the facility because there were some new things up, and it looked other things looked kind of spiffy, which of course Coyote needs. So I'm sure a Lonely Gathering will be a wonderful experience. Then on other things, I have a question about where the Walnut Grove assessment process is for Burrell. Somebody get back to me. We adopted some funds for that, and I'd like to know what's happening. Then, thank you for the new Iron Horse Trail and Contra Costa map. And the Native Peoples maps, I'm getting some today, which I'm going to share with people who are doing California Indian programs this fall. Loved going to save Mount Diablo's moonlight on the mountain. No moon, but the people were just great. And the event was a lovely one again. And then I think that same weekend, I took a hike up to Dow House. They're having their September O'Neill Festival, and one part of it is a hike from downtown Danville down the Iron Horse Trail up Camille to the house. And this year they called it Hills of Solace, hike to Dow House. And Ashley Adams was the hike leader from downtown, and a very lively naturalist. People really appreciated her. She was all set to talk, believe me, and did a wonderful job. Then I love the Pinole Shores Bay Trail Bridge. Honestly, just stunning. I especially love the logo that was embedded in. Thank you, Bob. And the low fencing that was set up around the interpretive panel and the bench where you could sit. And when I was there, there were three dogs, one of which was Kacha. And what kind of a dog is that? It was a golden, there were three golden doodles, and they took a picture of them in the new setting there. And it was really very funny to see these three together. Whitney and I went to the Martinez Fish and Wildlife Committee dinner at the Sportsman's Lodge in Martinez, which was, again, full of people who wanted to talk about bees and plants and waterfowl and creeks. And yeah, so now I'm pretty comfortable in that group, but, you know, that's not my normal milieu. And Danny Pellegrini, of course, led the fellas in doing a great barbecue. Then finally, I attended the Tri-Valley Women's Elected Lunch, and I did get to Livermore for a change. So I said a word on behalf of my fellow director who is running for office in that area. I want you to know that.
I appreciate your
Okay.
Office.
Thank you.
Thank you. On September 6th, I attended the executive committee meeting and also attended on the 7th the board field trip to Coyote Hills, and all the superlatives and wonderful things were said. I think it's wonderful. I'd also like to add that I think it's interesting what a great partner Dumbarton Quarry is. Associates, it seemed like Bob McCarrick was almost excited about this park as much as we are. They're a really great partner, and I really appreciate the efforts they put in. Moonlight on the Mountain was tremendous as always, and it's always great to see Ted Clement, and about as happy as he gets, I think. He was happy as a clam that night, and he's well shooting. It was a great event. On September 9th, I attended the Castor Valley Fall Festival and talked about parks and stuff with a lot of folks from Castor Valley. On September 11th, I had a great opportunity. I read my Sierra Club Yodeler activities guide every month, and I always see that every Tuesday at Lake Chabot, there's a hike at 4 o'clock in the afternoon on the short trail. They go to the dam. And I think I'd done it 20 years ago, but I went down and met the group. It's a wonderful group. It's called the Solo Sierrans. Dolores Grunewald runs this organization. Wonderful woman who's, when I spoke to her, said they've been doing this since 1980, every Tuesday. And she's been leading it since 1994. So I just really appreciate people like that. And I wasn't able to hike with them that time, but I'm surely going to join them because it's a wonderful cadre of people that hike out there every day. I think they do the same thing, but they're seeing something different every time at Lake Chabot, and they have dinner afterwards, so it was great to see those folks. I attended the Alameda County Special Districts Association meeting last Thursday. We learned about water from Zone 7 and a lot of other great things. I attended the Point Pinole Shores dedication. Once again, tremendous effort by everyone, and what a beautiful structure and shoreline. I attended the Board Operations Committee meeting on September 13th, and also that evening, as Member Corbett stated, we had the great opportunity to give the Radke Environmental Award to Eduardo Garcia. It was great, you know, we all got there, we were expecting Eduardo Garcia. I'm told through the grapevine, Doug Houston, that, well, don't get your hopes up, Dennis, and that speech that the staff did a beautiful job of preparing for me, forget it, give the award to somebody out in the audience. Eduardo's got invited by the governor to take a cruise out of the San Francisco Bay. But he showed up, and he stated that he'd rather be with us. Just because, not for any other reason, that we had invited him first, and he said he's loyal to his commitments, and he was very proud of this award, so it was a pleasure to give it to him, and the staff did an excellent job. Of course, I loved the venue. Last night, I attended the Castor Valley MAC meeting for the third time to try to describe our efforts in fire prevention and suppression along the Ten Hills Trail in Castor Valley. I'll leave it at that. I look forward to the employee picnic on the 26th, next Wednesday, I think it is. And also this Friday evening at 6 o'clock, something pretty new, I think, for the Park District. We're hosting, co-hosting the International Day of Peace celebration at Lake Chabot. It's at 6 o'clock. It's a 1 hour. This is a established by the United Nations. It's a day of peace. I've never been to it, but I plan on attending, so I think it'll be great. And I'll end with, I think it's a source of great pride that Bob gets the Pugsley Award, Ellen gets the Legacy Award. Let's get moving, the rest of us. Do something. No, congratulations. These are well-deserved awards. And Whitney got the Bay Award. That's right. That's Bay Hero Award. Boy, oh boy. Pressure's on the rest of us.
Wait, I just got an award. I was recognized as a Volunteer of the Month for the Friends of Cecil Creek.
I did my homework. Yes, please.
I was ill and could not go to the Farm Bureau, but you reminded me, talking about cut flowers, one of the things I was going to mention was how much we were going to miss Joe Perry, because he always brought a bouquet of his dried status, and everybody got that at that picnic. He was such a great guy. His family, I know, is going to carry on, but Joe was really special.
At that dinner, they read off the names of the people who had passed that used to be part of the Farm Bureau. There's a long list, and
sad. But Joe Perry was well remembered, yeah.
Kimberly?
I forgot to say that I thought this educational piece on Measure FF was very nice, very clear, and
good information.
Good information, so thank you.
All right, anything for the good of the order, or for the good of the order for anyone? Hearing none? I haven't forgotten that. In the same vein of Joe Perry, I'd like to adjourn the meeting in memory of Karen Lucas, a former Alameda City Council member and co-founder of Friends of Crown Beach. This was recommended by Director Seiden. I didn't know Karen Lucas. If anybody on the stand would like to say anything, if not,
I would just say that as a council member, she was always a very strong supporter of the Park District, and I guess one of her, you know, great loves and passion was the beach, and she was always there to support us, speak highly of us, and talk about the all the benefits the Park District has brought to Alameda. So,